Well, Michael Weiss is with a foreign policy think tank called the Henry Jackson Society. It's based in London, from where he joins me now. Michael, thank you for being with us. As Lawrence Lee pointing out there, there's a large number of people on the international stage striking very pompous poses of moral rectitude, all of them standing on pretty shaky foundations. How does one deal with a situation under these circumstances?
Look, I think diplomatically Syria is a mess, and it will continue to be so. You broadcasted earlier that Kofi Annan has called for dialogue between the opposition and the regime. It strikes me as the discourse about what to do about Syria is frozen in amber at many levels. This is 6 months ago. This is 8 months ago. The dissidents on the ground in Syria, the rebels in particular, who have taken up arms to defend themselves and their property and their families, they want no part of dialogue with the regime.
Well, isn't that just Russia, foolish?
Well, no, I don't think it is. I mean, let's assume they were to get dialogue. Let's assume the regime were to offer these people amnesty. And we're talking, by the way, of tens of thousands of people, civilians mostly, who have taken up arms. Would they trust the Mukhabarat? Would they trust these Shabia gangs that have been committing atrocities, going house to house, to leave them alone or to allow them to return to any kind of peaceful protest movement?
Well,
I think that would be extremely naive.
It seems then that you're taking John McCain's side and saying action should be taken here. But why should anyone trust the U.S. or the United Nations or anybody else who advocates this kind of policy? How is John McCain going to drop a bomb on Damascus, as he is saying very clearly, and that making sure that bomb differentiates between Syrians and Assad supporters? Ordinary Syrians.
Well, the military logistics of waging any kind of intervention in Syria are very complex. I mean, we saw testimony before the Senate Armed Services Committee about the air defense systems in Syria, which are located in densely populated urban cities. But look, I mean, a no-fly zone or a safe zone, these aren't just the only options on the table. You know, arming the rebels is one thing. I mean, the simple fact that you can't get a humanitarian corridor into the country to allow unobstructed aid into these sort of ravaged and besieged areas. I mean, I think you asked, who's going to trust the United States? Well, to be honest with you, the protesters. There were several days of rage in Syria over the last few months, one of which was called No Fly Zone Friday.
Well,
the one 2 weeks ago, or actually just last Friday, was called Arm the FSA Friday. So it seems like Syrians on the ground aren't that concerned about whether the U.S. is being hypocritical or U.S. policy with respect to Bahrain. They just want someone to save them.
Well, it would be an interesting conversation to talk about what the Syrians on the ground really want. Unfortunately, we don't have the time to do that, nor do we actually have the information,
sure,
because the only information that we seem to hear comes from the anti-Assad part of the government, even though there seems to be a fairly strong pro-Assad part to that government. So we can't really address that issue. What we can address, though, is the speculation here. You say that dialogue doesn't work. Again, why should we listen to the FSA on this? Isn't there a case to be made to suggest that the increasing pressure that the outside world is putting on Assad is actually making the problem worse? If the outside world steps back and says, right, we're not going to attack you if you sit down at the table with a previously defined committee of people that would try and solve the problems that you highlighted, wouldn't that give him a bit of breathing space? Wouldn't that actually be more likely to tempt him to back off?
Well, look, I mean, I think history is the guide here. He had all the breathing space in the world in the first few months of this uprising. Remember, this did not start as a call to arms or a call to topple the regime. This started actually as a reform uprising, protest movements in Damascus itself from the very start. It basically waged against the state corruption. What the regime did in response to that, when there was not a single person on the ground with a Kalashnikov, was to grab women by the hair, drag them to detention facilities, to snipe 12-year-old girls through their left eye. Fair play for an eye doctor, by the way. I think the Syrian people are very hardened and coarsened to what this regime is capable of doing at this point. There, it reaches a point after a year of this kind of bloodshed and violence, and I think Senator McCain was quite right to compare this to Milosevic, where the people just, you've traumatized the nation. It is a shattered country. And yes, you're quite right to say that there is a population in Syria that is very pro-Assad. I think a large driver for that is fear for what comes next. And it's a legitimate fear, by the way. But, I mean, look, we've seen videos, Al Jazeera has broadcast thousands of them, of people on the ground calling for toppling the regime. To ask them to step that back or walk it back after they've been made orphans or widows, I think it's very difficult a demand.
All right, we'll leave it there. Michael Weiss in London, thank you for talking to us.